please grab one of those and just sign in, let us know you were here, and even if you don't use your real name, let us know how many of you there are. We do like to kind of just kind of know what's going on in the life of the church. And speaking of which, you also have, people were handing them out at the door, they were on the tables, and there's some on the table at the back as well. There's an announcement sheet that just tells you a little bit about everything that's going on in the life of the church this week, and as we continue to make it through these holidays. And just as a reminder, we are still in the Christmas holidays. We have stored the Advent wreath because the time of Advent and anticipation is over. But we keep the Christmas tree out for a couple of weeks because we are still in the season of celebration. Christmas time is what the church calls it. The 12 days of Christmas, that's right. We're on what, the seventh day, maybe?
Yeah.
Get your swans today.
Right.
And then some of everything else you got over the last few days. Because we like to pile up. Maybe that's why gift giving is so crazy over Christmas. And we want to especially welcome any visitors that are here today. It's so good to have you. And if you would, please just give us a chance to speak to you. And there's some special gifts on the back table for you. And I guess that's about it. We're just going to go into worship today. We had scheduled another guest worship leader this morning, and he texted us this morning and was sick with a fever. So that's the way those things go. We have rerun and kind of put back together what we have with some other pieces. And I think we're ready to go, and we're excited to have you here with us this morning.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. Let's go ahead and stand up and sing a song. 10,000 Reasons Blessed. Thank you.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Now let's go together to God in prayer. Lord, we confess that we suffer today because of sin, both the sins we have chosen and the sins committed against us. We have done things we should not have done, and we have neglected to do those things we should have done. Save us from ourselves. Save us from the forces of evil in this world. We do not have the power to undo what has already been done. So grant us grace to bear present burdens and courage to change things that can be changed. Teach us how to live as those prepared to die and to live eternally with you and your child, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And Jesus has indeed come to save us and to show us the way to experience God's love. Jesus will strengthen us to the end, and we hear the good news that we are forgiven. And in unity with your Son, Jesus, and with each other, we claim his name and we pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we'll dismiss our children to Children's Church from ages 3 up through 2nd grade. You'll meet Miss Beth in the back. She will walk you over. And you'll have your special time when we have our special time.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
So, let me ask y'all a question as we start the morning. Anybody plan on making some resolutions this year and changing some things? Anybody? Nobody? Yes, I know. Okay. So, like, we're at that point where it's so funny because this is always that sermon that is the rah-rah sermon, right? That gets you into the next. Like, you either end this on Christmas and then you start after the fact. And, like, some of you all, like, New Year's resolutions, what's so funny about that? Like, you'll go to the point where you blow it and then you quit. You know that? Like, all right, I already blew it, so now, you know. It's like, I already ate a piece, let's eat the whole thing, right? That's where you kind of go. So, what I want to talk to you about today, and what I want to look at through this sermon series that we're getting ready to do over the next 6 weeks, is, and then believe it or not, there's just a little bit of time and we'll go right into Lent. And it just falls back to back on us. But I've preached it one other time. I don't think I did 6 weeks. I think I did four. And the name of it is The End of Me. How do I get to the end of me? And so what I want to look at this morning is a scripture. Do we put it in? Let me see that real quick. Is a scripture that is if you read it, it's almost impossible to live it out. Like, you know, a lot of times what Jesus is speaking in is what we call hyperboles. And a hyperbole is you want to get as close as you can to it, but because we're human, you can't totally get there, but you will achieve it in heaven. But if we were to guide our life by this, we would actually kind of get to the end of me. And I'm going to give you another scripture towards the end. And so this would be Jesus' longest sermon. And when it says his disciples came to him, he's not necessarily talking about just the 12 disciples. But Jesus kind of had some groupies. He kind of had a following. You know, they were like, you know, fish fans or deadheads. They were following them around everywhere. And so anyway, some people don't even know what fish is, but anyway. So now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And then 11 is so hard for us. But listen. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp, put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So we're right here on the threshold of doing something new. And New Year's brings about that time where the old year is ushered out and the new year comes in. And I think one of the reasons that Christians always look at 2019, 2020, whatever the year is, 2012, wherever you've been, but of course we're on the threshold of 19, is because grace and the new year kind of correspond. Like, you know, every day we get up, we have another opportunity. Like, as Christians, we can completely blow it the day before. And when we wake up, God loves us and said, let's start over. I think that's the most amazing thing about the Christian walk. Now, I'm not saying God wants you to continue to blow it over and over and over again. There'd be no discipleship in that. But let's face it, there are days where we just blow it. And so I think the reason that we always think about a new year is because it gives us new opportunities, it gives us new possibilities. And to be honest with you, a lot of us want to restart in our life. We want to restart something. We want to do over. We want to mulligan. We want, we want to get healthier. We want to mend relationships. We want to lose weight. We want to learn a new skill. We want to give up an addiction. There's all type of things that come about. And so basically what happens is, as we look at it, as we talk about it, the thing about it is we've already been to this place before. Like, maybe even last year we said, this is what I was going to do, but we didn't do it. Maybe we've done it for 5 years in a row, and we said, I'm going to kick that addiction, or I'm going to quit getting angry all the time, or I'm going to work on this, or I'm going to finish that project. And we just continue to be at that same place. And the reason I will tell you you're at that same place is because you have yet to get to the end of me. Me will keep you from doing what me needs to do. I know that sounds crazy. But that's what we're going to look at. That's what we're going to talk about. How can we get to the end of me? So, I've told you all this before. I should have put it up on the screen. There is an app for your phone, for your computer, called YouBible. Okay? It's simple. And it is put out by Craig Rochelle. And Craig Rochelle was going to be a United Methodist minister. And they said he was too radical. And they kicked him out. And now he worships about 20,000 people with seven different campuses. And one of the things that he began to pray about years ago was God has really given him a lot of resources. And so what he said is, I'm going to give them all away. I'm not going to sell any of them. I'm going to give them away. And he will tell you his church has been so blessed by what he's given away. So he came up with this app that is the YouBible app. And basically what you can do on that is you can actually go on and do a 7-day into me Bible study to start the year off, because you're not at the first yet. You can plug it in there, and it will actually send you reminders of that you didn't do your Bible study. Like, alert, 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 you're in trouble, you didn't do your Bible study, that kind of thing, right? And, you know, I know y'all got iWatches, and y'all got iPhones, and y'all got bells and whistles, and y'all got them things in the house that spy on you and listen to you, Alexis and all that. You got all that going on, so it will remind you that you need to do this study. Well, so I started that study last night, and I actually signed up for it last week and got on it. And the first day is writing a letter to yourself of why you're breaking up with me. Why am I coming to the end of me? Now, what's funny is I actually did this the day after Christmas. I was working on this sermon, and I sat down and I wrote this letter entitled, Dear Me. Dear me, I love you, me, but this is just not working out. I've been trying to please me for years, but I keep coming up empty with me. I've tried to put others first, but I just keep putting me before God, sometimes before my spouse, and sometimes before others' needs. I spend time on me and money on me when me does not have the money to spend on me. But me justifies that because I need to make me happy. I have allowed me to talk me into the things that me knew was wrong for me. You have encouraged me to talk to people in a way that has created a mess for me. So I just want to tell you that it is you, me, and this is where we part ways with me. I have now become and am at the end of me. Signed, Steve Strange, December 26, 2018. So what does that mean? What does it mean to come to the end of me? And here's what I would say. You're not truly going to have the relationship that God wants you to have with him till you come to the end of me. So Cal Edelman is my mom's pastor in Kentucky. It's another very large church, Southeast Christian. And Cal Edelman, they have a big staff. They have over 100 staff members on their one campus. And one day Cal Edelman gets into the office and his administrative assistant says, Cal, you've got two calls. It's a Monday. And he has preached on Sunday, and these two people have called. And the first one is somebody that I think is trying to set up a funeral or something, and one of their older people in their family had died, and they're trying to get all the things together and just ask if Kyle could call and talk to him. The other message that Kyle has is that it's from a father who wants to talk to Cal, who has recently lost a 2-year-old child. And they really want to talk to Cal about some different things. And Cal, being a church with 20,000 people, you don't know everybody. And so Cal doesn't really know how this father lost the child or what it's all about. He just knows that he needs some pastoral care. And so Cal makes the easy call first, which is not really an easy call, but deal with the funeral, and then he sits and he prays for a minute, and he's like, okay, I'm going to pick up this next. And so he calls this guy on the phone, and he says, listen, I got a note that you needed me to call you. I want to tell you I'm so sorry that you lost this child. And he said, you know, I know how difficult it can be losing a child at any age, but to lose a 2-year-old is just terrible. And you know, I just want to tell you that I'm praying for you. And he says to the guy, he says, now, I'm going to be honest with you. Our church is so large, I really don't know what happened. Like, I don't really know how you lost your child. So could you share that with me? And then there's this moment of pause. And you know one of those moments of silence where, like, it's probably 10 seconds, but it seems like eternity? That's what this was. And finally, the voice on the other end of the phone said, I backed over him with the car. It just changes the whole story, doesn't it? What do you say? What do you do? And it's at that point that the other voice on the phone said, listen, Kyle, the reason I'm calling you is because I want to share what God has done in my life during this time. I want to minister to other people. Because see, I was a priester. I came on Christmas and Easter, and I came a few times in between, but I wasn't really committed to God. But let me tell you something. After you accidentally kill your child, there's nowhere to run. And so I got to the end of me, and right now I'm just living in the arms of Jesus. See, the problem is there are going to be events in our life that are bigger than me, that are bigger than you, that are bigger than you can handle. Sometimes it's going to be your fault. You know, a lot of what we do is our fault. Decisions we've made. Decisions we continue to make. You know, my football coach used to tell me all the time in college. Matter of fact, in the Tigers' den, as we'd walk out, he would have a sign, and it said, what you are to become, you are now becoming. He said, you can't expect one day to get up and be something different than what you've programmed yourself to be. And basically, that was a great lesson on you got to become and come to the end of you to step into that true presence of God. There might be some things in your life that there are no way you can handle, no way that you can foresee, no way that you can do things. So as Cal was preparing a sermon about the end of me, he put out on social media, after talking to this father, this question. And I want to pose this question to you. If you take notes or you write, this is a good place for you to start. But the question is this. Jesus became real when? In other words, when did Jesus become real in your life? And I've told you this before. For me, it was when I was 21 years old. And I was in the dorm room, and my life was just falling apart. And I really didn't care if the sun came up tomorrow. I really didn't. I couldn't find any significance in myself and really couldn't find any significance in life. And it was at that point, that day in my life where God became so real to me, where Jesus became. But it took me getting to the end of me. So listen to some of the responses on social media. These are some of the responses of when Jesus became real. When the divorce papers finally arrived. Here's one. When I was pregnant with kidney disease and my baby's life and my life were in danger. When my wife found out that I was addicted to porn. When the foreclosure notice finally arrived. When I lost my job that I had been at for 33 years. When my depression became so unmanageable that I could not bear another moment. When I found out that my husband had gotten another woman pregnant. At that point, there's surrender. At that point, the situation is bigger than we can control or we can handle. And at that point, we step out of me and give it to God because there's no person that can help with how you feel in those situations, because none of us, no matter who we are, understand what you're really going through except for God. And somehow we've got to get to this place where it's the end of me. One final thing that was on that Facebook or social media message was one guy summed up all these other things when he said this: I found Jesus and Jesus became real when I got to the end of me. And so the reason we haven't made changes in our life is because we haven't got to the end of me yet. We haven't got to a place where we really quit doing it on our own and we give it to God. Here's what we do so much, and I'm great at doing this. I will give it to God, and then at 2 hours later, I'll take it back. Or a day later, I'll take it back. I'm like, God, you got this, God. Only you can solve this. And then I'm trying to solve it. I'm busy in the middle of it. And God the whole time is like, just give it to me. Just let me have it. Let me have it. You know, I was reading an article this week and it caught my attention. Of course, I love sports. But more than wins and losses, I love the stories behind sports. I love the story of the kid with cancer at the Purdue game that became a captain. It's brought a lot of awareness to cancer. I love those type of stories. And I wish we focused more on that. But I heard a story, and the reason it caught my attention is because when I was helping coach in Fayette, the head coach was, of course, Coach Tucker. And Coach Tucker played behind a guy named Freddie Kitchens. And Freddie Kitchens happened to be in this newspaper article. And if you know about Freddie, Freddie didn't have a great reputation on campus. My brother, some others were there. And I mean, he was known to party a little bit, to get a little out of hand and all that. And so he's kind of grown up. You know, we kind of label all these people that make bad decisions when they're 17, 18, 19, 20. Maybe 50. But we try to label them, right? And so Freddie got kind of labeled with that. So if you know where he is now, he's working with Baker Mayfield. And he is the Browns' offensive coordinator, quarterback coach, and he's working with Baker. But what people don't understand is last year, a year ago, he was diagnosed with a very, it's a hereditary disease, but he was diagnosed with a disease where the aorta splits. And you bleed out into your cavity. And they told him, they're like, dude, you're probably going to die. Now, I'm sure he probably makes good money. But I'm sure money didn't matter at that point. As a matter of fact, what caught my eye was the Christmas letter that he wrote to his family. And I love it because it talks about coming to the end of me. Listen to just a little bit of it. Actually, it was a few years ago that this actually happened. It's 2013. In 2013, I suffered an aortic dissection, a hereditary issue that causes the aorta to split and my blood to run between the walls instead of its natural path. Facing long odds of survival, I realized how much I meant to the people around me. It's amazing how people will let you know how much you mean to them when they think there is a possibility you're going to die. After emergency surgery, during the 2 months of rehab, when I was home and trying to get back to training camp, there were two things that made me the most thankful man in the world. Besides my gratitude for God helping me to survive, I'm still most thankful for these two things. The first is the quality of time my wife and I were able to spend together during the healing process. Our time together was priceless because she was with me every step of the way and helped me to make a full recovery. The second thing was having the what if I had died thoughts. One would think I would have regrets of the things I did wrong earlier in my life, and believe me, there were plenty of those. However, the main regrets were the things that I had never did or never said. Those are the regrets. Because he got to the end of me. And he realized that his life and investing in other people's life was the end of me. You know how Jesus got to the end of me? He said, "It is finished." That was him taking his last breath for you. That was him coming to the end of me. And so why is it so hard for us to get there? Why is it so hard for us to get to a place where we surrender totally to God? Look, I struggle with this too. Just because I'm standing talking don't mean I got this all together. I mean, and here's why. First of all, me doesn't like to confront me. Right? I mean, I'm usually right. Even if I'm wrong. Right? I mean, because my pride says if I'm wrong, the world sees me in a different way. And yet what the scripture calls us to do is to come to him and give it, lay it all out. Here's the funny thing. Do you realize we don't hold secrets from God? Like God knows everything. Right? And yet we live our lives as like we can hide what we're doing from God. But here's the most amazing thing. God loves you on your best day. God also loves you on your worst day. And you know what? I never understood that until I became a parent. So I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes them little boogers, like you walk by the room and you go, "What in the world? I love you so much." This is who we are. That's who God is. That's where God wants to bring us. The other thing is, me does not like to swallow pride. We don't like to stand up and say, "I got a problem." I tell you what, one of the most amazing things happens at CR, Celebrate Recovery, Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous. And the most amazing thing that happens is that they cannot walk into those programs and get better and hide who they are. They got to lay it out on the table. They got to get to the end of me. If they're truly going to get better, they got to take every bit of pride, they got to set it up on the shelf and say, "I can't do this." Because they can't. The disease has overtaken them. And for some of us, we're in that same boat. Here's what we're good at. Me is good at hiding who me really is from the rest of the world. You realize that? We're awesome at hiding who we really are. Because we perceive the notion that if everybody sees that everything is good on the outside, then me can get by with not really it being good on the outside. Inside. Sorry. And so we hide it. And that's the prideful issue. So let me move on. So here's the foundational statement that Jesus made in Luke 9, verse 23, that sums up coming to the end of me. And I want you to listen to it. Then he said to them, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it." And then here's the verse. "What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit me, self?" What good is it? And here's what happens with this. A lot of times we read this scripture and we read it in the future context thinking, "Oh, this is what happens when we go to heaven." No. See, here's the funny part about that. You don't have to die to yourself in heaven, because there is no sin. There is no pain. There is no sickness. There is no what's going on in the world today. And so often we've read this scripture over and over again and we're like, "Well, that means when I die, I'm trading." No. That is how we have to live every day. If you want to be my disciple, here's the funny thing. We don't need disciples in heaven. Everybody there's already saved. This is a present tense verse where Jesus is saying, unless you die to yourself, unless you get to the end of me, it's going to be hard for you to be a disciple. It's going to be hard for you to give up what you're trying to give up, what you're trying to do, what you're trying to be, where you're trying to go, what you're trying to finish. That's where it all comes. And this explanation is the end of self. So why do we want to come to the end of self? Two quick points. The first is because we want to be loved and we want to love. Me seems to always get in the way of loving anyone but me. But we actually love others more when we love me and love others. You realize that? You know, at some point in your life, hopefully, you swap and you enjoy watching somebody else receive a gift more than you like receiving a gift. That's what that's talking about. Your transformation is now that you love others even more than you love yourself. And in doing so, you love yourself more. Isn't that amazing? And then finally, is the second point is this, that we want to make a difference in this world. Have y'all ever been to a funeral of somebody that just really wasn't a good person? I know it's just morbid to think about. But like, you're sitting there and like the pastor is like struggling with like words to say good about this person. I've done a few funerals like that. It's miserable. Like you're like, God, please don't let me be a liar. Please don't let me be a liar. Please don't let me be a liar. But God, let me do this the right way. You know, to me, that's the worst thing in the world. But when we get to the end of me, we start to believe that God can use us in other people's lives. And we begin to write the story, not about who I am, but about who God is, about who Jesus is. See, what if our goal in 2019 was not to make me famous? And I'm not talking about Steve, I'm talking about you as me, but to make Jesus famous. What would your legacy be? What would people say about you? That's what we want to do. We want to make a difference in the world. So over the next 6 weeks, we're going to look at how to do this. How do we get to the end of me? And here's your premise, once again, out of Matthew 5. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, because theirs will be the kingdom of heaven. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to write that note. I want you to come to the end of me. And then I want you to evaluate who do you want to become this year in Jesus, in God? And then, I promise you, all of 2019 will fall in place. But the first thing you got to do is you got to get to the end of me. Let's pray. God, this morning we come and we hear your word. So often it's always been just about me and everything I do, and yet I'm reminded of that night when it should have been about you, that you washed your disciples' feet. And after that, you put back on your garment, because you had washed them probably with the garment that you were wearing, probably your prayer cloth. And then you served them. They should have been serving you. It was your last meal. And yet, even in that, you were at the end of me. And you said, this is my body, broken for you. Take, eat. Give thanks. Do this in remembrance of me. And on that night, you also took the cup. You poured it. You gave thanks. You said, take, drink. This represents the new covenant. My blood poured out for you. This truly is the end of me and the beginning of you and your eternal life. God, we thank you for this gift of bread, this gift of wine. God, let it be for us a reminder that coming to the end of us is a way for us to move forward in you and through you. God, we love you so much for this gift. Let us share now in your meal. In Jesus' name, amen. If I can have our servers to come forward. Our band. Come, receive. We will take offerings at the plate or at the table. So. Sinner, I'm here.
Impossible, Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
So receive the benediction. God, let us come to the end of ourselves in 2018 and pick you up in 2019. God, sometimes it's so hard to lay down ourselves. But sometimes, God, you are the only thing that will fill the emptiness, the addiction, the brokenness, the severed relationships. You're the only thing that will get us to where we need to be. God, thank you for this lesson and for the sermons that will come. But God, let us go now and celebrate the new year. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.